Halifax, Nova Scotia's connection to 9/11. This is the untold true story of my meeting the terrorists, written by Daniel J. Towsey, September 11, 2010. Okay, first I will tell you about the widely publicized news stories that were reported on all the local corporate news media in Halifax, Nova Scotia, Canada, on the east coast by the Atlantic Ocean, not far from New York City, on the day of 9/11 and the next day. This story is very easily verifiable in Nova Scotia. 1 in 3 people clearly remember these news stories I am about to tell you about. Please understand that I have and am risking my life to write this and publish it. I am writing this now in hopes that maybe one day the good people of this world will rise for truth, justice, and liberty. I hope that this information will be spread far and wide and that everyone takes this very seriously. I also hope that by my writing this, it will actually afford me some protection from those in authority that were involved. But after a recent attempt on my life after a car was deliberately driven over me, where the local authorities were involved, I have decided to write this out. You can read my article entitled, How to Assassinate a Cyclist, for the details of the attempt on my life that has left me severely and permanently injured and crippled. Okay, here goes. On 9/11, it was reported on all local news outlets that the terrorist's car was found at the Halifax International Airport and that the car was filled with evidence, such as flying information and a copy of the Quran. This is the same story that was later told about a car being found at the Boston airport. You will now read why the story was transferred from Halifax, Nova Scotia to the Boston airport. It was also reported that another group of terrorists that came from Halifax were also seen the night before partying at a strip joint in the town of Yarmouth, Nova Scotia, which is on Nova Scotia's westernmost edge, where the ferry runs from Yarmouth to Maine. This story was big news on all media in Nova Scotia. Unfortunately for the shadow government conspirators, this story was blown out of the water when the bar owner in Yarmouth told the whole world that the terrorist story was true, but that the untold truth was that these terrorists had actually missed embarking on the ferry at the correct time, which would have given them the time to drive to Boston to get on the alleged hijacked plane. Again, this story is very easily verifiable. Everyone in Yarmouth knows this. Any reporters that wish to go to Yarmouth can ask just about anyone. Everyone remembers this. The local media's quickly suppressed this very televised story and never mentioned it again. Everyone in Nova Scotia cannot understand why such a huge story was never again mentioned and why there has never been an explanation given to the public as to why the story disappeared off the front pages or any other pages. Well, now you are about to find out why. This is going to be a very long story about organized crime, Hells Angels, the Freemasons, and about my father, stepfather, and their friend who were the real founders of Hells Angels. That makes me the son of Hells Angels. But I have chosen to be a truth soldier, for God is the truth. My father, originally known as Paul Arthur Towsey Sr., who long ago escaped to Australia and changed his name to Arthur Paul Towsey, was in the Air Force, a child abuser, tyrant, and very evil. Marty Goodman was a lifelong pedophile. He once abused my daughter. I have not seen him since. These three all worked for Encyclopedia Britannica, that I believe was a cover for crooks to launder their money and use as a cover to justify their illicit incomes. My Jewish stepfather Sally, Sonny Viner, who still lives in Dartmouth and is still alive, ran, owned, and operated numerous, across Canada, Hells Angels clubhouses, nightclubs, gaming houses, and I believe still does. He was also part owner of a police club in Dartmouth. That club was called the Billy Club. Sally have run a gambling business in his home where local police and other underworld criminals would play poker in his basement. I know for sure that many police were corrupt and involved in Hells Angels. Do not believe for a second that they were working undercover. They just used Hell's Angels to do their dirty deeds of covert activities against innocent people. These, Sonny, Marty, and my dad, oh, and very likely another guy we only knew as itch three, went to Las Vegas on their motorcycles back in the 40s, and then after traveled through the USA and Canada and set up the Hell's Angels organization. Yes, it originated from the Jewish Mafia in Las Vegas. Sally back in approximately 1971 was all over international news for having paid an American company to rig a professional television media video camera with a hidden laser that was then set up at the Kentucky Derby. This camera was to be used to send invisible lasers at the target horse, causing it to lose its stride. Sally and his conspirators had bet and invested what today would be over $25 million. The conspirators bought tickets on the long shots. They would have made millions. But the FBI was tipped off by the manufacturer, and the FBI were very intrigued about this weapon and what it would be used for. The FBI was also curious because they wondered why a Canadian from Toronto would want to buy a weapon that they could not bring over the border to Canada. So the FBI followed the trail and waited until this device was set up at the races. They arrested Sally Viner and he got 9 years in Rochester Penitentiary. I was 10 years old then and remember the story being all over the news. The police ransacking our home. The neighbors all knew. We were all now outcasts. One day government spooks came to our house and asked me and my brothers to write sobby letters to our stepfather saying that we miss you, we love you and we need you. None of us wanted to write these letters, so the spooks wrote them themselves, and these letters were used to get a judge to release Sally after 2 years. The judge said, "You have a family in Canada that needs you." He was ordered never to re-enter the USA. He then returned and lived with my family in hiding at a place called Pontypool in Ontario. I did not go with them. After 1 year they moved to Dartmouth, Nova Scotia, 1973. But after moving to Dartmouth, he did return many times to Las Vegas with my mother. Many years later my mother was poisoned, Dartmouth, and died because she refused to give up her Roman Catholic beliefs and marry Sally as a Jewish woman. Back in 1971 Toronto, I told Sally I did not want to live with him, and then I moved into Clifton House for Boys near Riverdale Park in Toronto. After living in Pontypool, Sally was ordered by the mafioso to move to Dartmouth, Nova Scotia, the birthplace of the Freemasons that erected what I believe was the first Masonic wall in North America in 1785. I believe that Sally is probably the head of the Masons here. I eventually moved to Dartmouth as my three brothers and my mother lived here. I only lived with them for 6 months and then I returned to Toronto. The town called Dartmouth is a 10-minute ride across the bridge that spans the harbor to Halifax. The locals have a very accurate name for this town. It is called the Dark Side, or Darkness. Okay, now I will get into the 9/11 terrorists and how I met them in their homes. Please also note that I never condoned or participated in the Hell's Angels organization. But I have been an insider privy to a lot of knowledge as to its organization and how the minds of the criminally insane works. I have been in many Toronto gaming houses they called bridge clubs and some Hell's Angels houses. When I was in my teens in Toronto I worked as a cook and cleaner in some bridge clubs until one was busted by the cops and I had enough. The cops blacklisted me and terrorized me ever since. If you read many of my other personal articles I have published, you can learn a lot more about my history. CSIS, Canada's Secret Intelligence Service, police and all other authorities have terrorized me and have been on a mission to destroy my life. They have engaged in numerous very serious covert criminal acts against me. They have framed me for crimes I never committed. The whole story would take a book to explain. Well, back in 2000 I started a new business here in Dartmouth named Silver Spoon Trading. It was a used goods business, where I restored used appliances, bicycles, lawnmowers and a lot more. I also exported sold used goods to the ship's crew from Cuba. I would bring a cube vanload of goods to the ship, the Mariel, that came to an unprotected dock in the Halifax harbor every 2 weeks. I later discovered that this was a government-organized crime ship that would bring a huge shipments of illegal drugs into Halifax after having diverted to Mexico every second trip to pick up the load. I reported this to the authorities and soon realized they knew and allowed it to happen. I then had my life threatened and I stopped selling to the Cubans. If you read my published article, The HRM Storm, you will learn about my business, silver spoon trading, and how the government put me out of business. But also, the location of this business was actually formerly a Hell's Angels clubhouse that had been owned by my stepfather. He actually loaned me the money to start up my business there. But at the time I did not know it was previously Sully's Club and that it was located there. I had been there a couple of times over the years previously but never knew it had been a secret Hell's Angels clubhouse. But that was long before I opened my business there. The Lebanese property owner operated his variety store above my store. His store was facing the other, backside, of my business and it was on the street up above behind my business. My business was on the other side on a road with a lower elevation. So I spent a lot of time speaking with this guy called Nabi. We spent many hours talking about government corruption and many other issues. I never hated government, I just hated the corrupt people that operated in the shadows of the government committing crimes against the people and democracy. So that he and especially his friends, in particular a very aggressive guy named Sid, who always appeared to be under extraordinary pressure, believed that I was connected and could be trusted as they knew who my stepfather was, the mafioso boss. Until one day, Sid said to me that I could come over to three different houses that he had where I could buy anything in the homes for very cheap. He told me something very odd. He told me that the families were going back home to some Arab country and that the husbands were not going with them. I had been operating a small moving business called Cheap But Good Movers with my oversized black cube van. So Sid drove me to two different homes in a well-off Bedford neighborhood and to another tall apartment building in Halifax. I found the whole experience extremely strange and bizarre. I felt I was into something very scary indeed. The husbands were the most scared and nervous people I had ever seen in my life. I had moved hundreds of families before and knew that this nervousness and tension was not right. I realized something was very wrong here. But I did not know what. The wives and children were very agitated and angry. So in the first home I noticed that the home was not furnished enough to actually live there properly. I looked around to see if there was anything I was interested in buying. I then saw and asked about a very unusual satellite receiver on top of the television. The receiver appeared to be connected to a computer. This was not something from Canada as it was all Arabic. Sid got really nervous at my looking at and touching this specialized satellite device. It appeared to be for a private network. Sid got very protective of it and he moved me away from it. Sid never took me through the house. He never showed me anything that I could buy. He then took me to another house where again he never told me of anything I could buy. I thought this so strange. He was not offering me anything to buy and I wondered why was he wasting my time. Then he took me to Halifax later in the evening and the same thing happened. He did not offer me anything I could buy. I said hi, I would be interested in buying that television. He said I could not buy it right now. So I said when would I be able to come back to get it. Sid did not answer me. By now I thought that this whole thing appears to be a setup of some kind and that I was somehow being implicated in something. But knew not what. Sid's aggressiveness was actually very intimidating, he was very scary. And I do not scare easy as I have met many very dangerous people in my life. So I really wondered what made him so. I then realized that this guy was never to be trusted and that he was very evil. So I returned home with nothing and thought what a waste of time and gas. The next day, September 10, 2001, I had a conversation with Sid. Sid lived across the street from the Bill's store that was above my store. He was so absolutely tense it was scary. Well, he brought up some political discussion about the USA and said the most strangest thing. He said that very soon something really big was going to happen in the USA and that it would be like or could start a third world war. He said that the United States was going to be attacked. Now I really had enough and was completely scared of this guy. I walked away and never told anyone what he said because I did not know what he was talking about. Later that day, Nabi told me something about how Arab suicide terrorists were recruited. He told me that a man would be approached or chosen. Told that he would be put up in a nice home in Canada with his family for up to 10 years. And that all costs would be covered. That the terrorist would not be told what and when his mission would be. The suicide terrorist was told that he had no choice and that if he refused, him, his family and relatives would all be killed. I was shocked at learning this and wondered why he was telling me this. Nabi was a good guy. It seemed to me that he wanted me to know something and I did not know why. Well, the next day, September 11, 2001, I fully realized what I had seen, heard and experienced the two previous days. When the local media reported the story about the terrorist car and the Yarmouth incidents, I connected all the pieces. I summarized that Saleh, the local police, the Lebanese, Arab Jews, were all involved. The reason I include the local police was because of their cover-up of my information. So after that, the police called my vehicle insurance company, Economical Insurance, and told them to cancel my insurance. I then lost my moving business. The police were also responsible for me losing my cube van that was in a repair shop. They told the mechanic to not return it to me so I could not make any money to pay off the fines the police gave me for no insurance. Even though I actually had paid insurance for the whole year. And a clean driving record. The mechanic kept my $30,000 heavy-duty Ford cube van for a bill of about $3,000 for replacing the rear axle. I had to move down the street to a smaller home, where the upstairs and downstairs tenants mysteriously moved out and then my home was invaded by youth gangs, pimps, drug dealers, and more. There was over 50 people that I had never met before. All my doors and windows had been broken into. These people stayed day and night, ate all my food and would not leave. But I, being a photographer, decided to tell them that I loved taking pictures and they went along. So I was able to get the names they gave me and match them up with the pictures. I was now broke and had no income. I was afraid to leave my home. I had no food and could never get any sleep. I was threatened when I asked them to leave. Many of the young people knew nothing about the setup. I think they were just told I was cool and they could hang out at my place. But the adults that came in were very dangerous. So I tried to befriend them and tried to understand the situation I was in. It would take a lot more writing for me to tell all. I realized that someone was trying very hard to frame me for something. Well, their plans were backfiring. I called 911 emergency several times. The police came into my house looking for some of these individuals. One detective actually had large pictures of two of the guys that were in my house. I found that strange, and when I asked the detective how he knew who was in my house and why he had these pictures, he took off. One night, black guys were breaking in. I had taken the opportunity to barricade my front door when the gang had left. So they tried to kick the back door in, but I was blocking it. I had turned off all the lights. It was nighttime. I realized that would give me the advantage as I knew my way around in the dark. These black guys then pried the back window and were halfway in. I stood there in the dark. They did not know for sure that I was in the house. I scared the hell out of the black guy. I was inches from him in the dark. He had not seen or heard me. I told him I had an axe in my hand and that he had better get back out or I would hurt him with it. He got so scared and climbed back out. The other black guy and him just about fell off the narrow roof they were standing on. I then went back into my office and jammed my large mechanics tool just against the door. The black guys were outside and banging really loud on the house. The house was shaking. I was completely terrorized. I then called 911 emergency and was frantic. I broke down and cried. The police never came. The next day, two teenage girls, the black girl that really hated me and I did not know why, and a white girl named Jen. Jen and I got along well. She knew I was a good guy. Then the black girl would not give me my digital cell phone. Then she opened the door and let these guys in that had masks on. The leader immediately asked for my cell phone, which the black girl took out of her pocket and handed over. He then broke the phone. There was six of them, and with precision each one spread out to every room and secured the scene. The leader told me that they were here to kill me. He told me not to try to resist as they had a gun. He lost his mask and I saw his face. He then approached me and pushed my right shoulder back. Spun me around, pulled me back while he had his arm locked around my neck and put his knee into my back. He was choking me to death. I was not breathing. Note, this caused a permanent injury to my throat. They brought the two girls out to witness the execution and Jen screamed out to the guy to stop as she realized he was killing me. He calmly asked her if she was sure. And she said yes and he let go. Everything was very calm. The guy told me to sit down. He looked around and told the other guys to grab some stuff. And they argued that they did not need anything. The leader got mad, they grabbed my large television and left. They wanted it to look like a robbery. I was so scared as I knew I could not call the police as they told me not to call them and that they, the police, were the ones that had sent all these thugs to my home. The police threatened that they would put me in jail if I called 911 emergency again. So now my home was a mess. I was totally devastated. I then left my house. I rode my bicycle away. I did not drive my car and I left it in the driveway. I never saw my car again. The police later stole it. I called my ex-wife and told her some of what was going on. Anyway, I told the hospital I was suicidal, which was not true. I was just beaten and I felt so endangered. I needed a place to be safe. So I got myself admitted to the Nova Scotia Psychiatric Hospital for my protection. That night, the whole ward was emptied and there was this very nasty woman behind the counter at a distance from me, screaming at me that, "We do not want you here." I was so burned out, exhausted from no sleep or food. I had no will to even respond. I just walked away. I had replaced my cell phone earlier that day and made a phone call to the FBI number in New York City for anyone with information about 9/11. I told the FBI agent about my meeting the terrorists. I spent the next 3 months in there while the police stole my car and trailer out of my driveway. Some friends tried to retrieve a few of my belongings. But I lost most of my things. I later moved into a group home where I lived for the next 5 years. Where I stayed on my computer and continued researching to get an understanding of what is going on in this world and why. For those of you who have read some of my previous articles, read my first article, Corrupt Canadian Elections, about my working on an election campaign in 1984 in Toronto, where my friend lawyer Michael Cohen was running against the then very corrupt Solicitor General of Canada, who created CSIS. 6 months into the campaign, Canada's secret police, and issued a contract on my life. Bob Kaplan angrily screamed at me that, We are going to destroy you. We are going to make you so destitute that you'll have to resort to crime to survive. And when you do, we will put you in jail where we will have our fun with you. During the campaign, I took care of our campaign signs. I went out at night when there was less traffic. Then one night a police officer in North York came over and told me he had a message for me. He was told to tell me that Bob Kaplan had issued a contract on me. Since then, they have systematically destroyed my life and I have been terrorized by XIS covert agents. They have engaged in psychological warfare on me. They have laughed at me and said that we can do anything we want to because you cannot tell anyone, for they won't believe you and there is nothing they can do. Not only that, if you try to tell anyone, we will just label you as delusional or paranoid and lock you up. Then they walked away just laughing. Well, I have never given up on the concepts of truth, justice and liberty for all, and I kept my promise to God. Please read my article with the same name. There has been numerous very serious events in my life as a result of their out-of-control activities. I hope one day that all good people will realize that no republic or democracy can function if their governments are allowed to operate behind veils of secrecy. I hope that one day everyone will realize that the single most dangerous thing to any free society is secret societies. Secrecy is only to hide their evil and wrongdoings. All secret societies and its members should be vilified and criminalized. And then these criminally insane should be put into a very comfortable straitjacket and then escorted to a place with very melodic music playing. Now I sit imprisoned in my home. I am physically disabled. I am unable to get any justice. I am being denied any medical help. I have a broken back with numerous fractured or damaged discs, broken ribs, a prosthesis in my upper right arm, loss of my large intestine, and many other injuries. It is amazing that I am alive. I am not being permitted to see any doctors that could put some pins in to secure my spine. The shadow government is interfering in everything in my life, and all those that work for the government care not or just follow directions. The days of a society guided by truth, justice, and liberty no longer exist. We now have those that speak no truth and seek no truth in full control. If the future of humanity is not guided by truth, then we are all doomed. That is where we are now, for no one in my society is offering any kind of help or justice to me. The spooks have absolutely convinced everyone that I am nuts, and everyone just chooses to blindly trust those that they perceive to be in charge. The common people seems to believe that there are those in the government that know everything. Wake up, people. Those in charge are just ordinary people who are completely corrupted with their out-of-control power. The good people need to get involved and start caring about truth. You'll first need to turn off all your sources of corporate information and tune into the People's Free Underground Press, which is located mainly on the internet. You can start here, danieltowsey.wordpress.com. Note, I clearly understand why they tried to implicate Canada in 9/11. It was to justify the passing of the previously written anti-terrorism laws that were guaranteed to take away the people's freedoms and liberties. Another thing. There never were any terrorists on any aircraft. The whole thing was staged. There were no commercial aircrafts that hit the WTC or the Pentagon. I and the bar owner in Yarmouth foiled their plans to implicate Canada in their insane New World Order schemes. Please wake up, people. We are all in serious trouble. Please read my "They Want You Dead" is written in stone. Tap water will kill you. Please read my other 911 articles, "The Gray Plane That No One Saw," and "How to Rip Off Your Lease and Make Billions." Check out 911 justice@halifax.wordpress.com.